guys, welcome back. I'm in the 7140 Case Magnum tractor. It's a well-used tractor, but it does a good job. I gotta go get a grain auger. We gotta get fertilizer on this farm, so we're ready to start planting. Because we got seed, we need fertilizer, and we gotta get equipment ready. And we are making progress. Okay, got the auger hooked up. I'm just gonna air some tires, and I'll run it over to the bin, and hopefully be ready for that truck, because we don't wanna be late. Before you can put an auger on a bin, you gotta open the lid up. These Meridians are pretty tall, there's no cage on them, so it's a little dangerous climbing the ladder. But fortunately, these lids have a tilt system with a string on the back, so you can just pull a string, opens the lid, and then just back the auger over the top. What do you think, Kobe? Is it ready? Is it ready to go? Oh, here comes the truck. I guess we're ready. That's one load in there. We're gonna have one more put in that bin, maybe even a third. They can hold about three of those trucks, but that should get us through this year of farming. So we just dropped the manifold. This is what goes underneath the hopper tanks. And these are the tubes that take the product out to their drill. We gotta put the meters in because we took them out over the fall. So underneath the manifold here, guys, there's three hoppers on this cart. Front, usually typically, is what we run our seed product in. That's our clean tank, I guess you could say it, because fertilizer we consider dirty, corrosive. The rear two are our fertilizer. Those two tend to get corroded because fertilizer is nasty stuff. Not to humans, that's true, I wouldn't eat it, but it's bad on metal. Oxidizes, not good. So what I gotta do is I gotta put what these are. These are your meter rollers. What basically these are going to determine how much product is going to go down. So at the rate these spin, there's a calibrated amount per chamber on here that's then going to distribute product from inside the tanks out through the manifold out to the drill. So you would take these off when you're done seeding so that you can clean them up. There's bearings inside these that's got to turn. That's a bearing, that's a bearing, that's a bearing, and they'll seize up. And so we got to make sure the bearings turn freely. Make sure the covers are all sealed up right. Put the rollers back up in, put the covers back up in. I got a tube of silicone there because some of the rubber gaskets are bad. The tanks are pressurized, so you can't let a lot of, you don't want the air to be leaking anywhere. So let's put these up in there, get them installed, and get one step closer to getting to the field. One step closer. Oh, those things can be a bugger. Awkward under here, heavy, not a lot of space. If you tore your ACL and had a patella tendon repair graft done, it's hard to be on your knees. That's me. But yeah, we got it done. I think someday when we upgrade these air drills to a better system, I hear the newer style carts are a lot easier on the farmer. That's okay. Just gotta do this twice a year, right? All right, we are getting closer. This tractor's just about ready. My dad went through it the other day. Fluids are good, grease is good. I'm going through it now and I'm just checking some tire pressures just to make sure the inner duals are up to snuff for the rest. The cart's pretty good, rollers are in. Gotta calibrate it still, but we haven't gotten product out to put it in it. It's gonna rain in a day, so we don't really wanna put any product out in these yet until the rain goes by. So we're gonna keep tinkering on these things just to make sure they're fine tuned and ready. Do the other one too, and then back in the shop while it rains to work on the 525-50, which is gonna be the 650.
I've had a couple people ask, why is there two drive lines in the center of this big bud going both directions? Let me show you.
So this top drive line right here is the power coming out of the transmission. That is the main power off. The engine and the transmission goes into this right here. That's a chain case. There's a big heavy chain in here. Drops the power down to then right here where it splits into this drive line, which then powers your front differential, front axle. And then out the back side right here, you can see it comes out the back and powers your back axle. So one drive line from the transmission down to chain case splits. One goes to the front that way and one goes to the rear that way. Now you know. There goes one. Okay, let's get the rollers in that one too, right here. One thing that's notorious about these loading augers on these air carts, especially this model, is they put bearings at the bottom. That's the old bearing right there. Of the auger right here. Well, that's great and all, except for water and fertilizer dust gets inside there and destroys these things. And then they come apart and then you just leak fertilizer product on the ground. Leg Arms already built one for the other auger. I just did this one. Just cut a nylon bushing, laid it out to an inch inner diameter, and then built a little housing around it. So now it's got a nylon bushing in there with a small tolerance on each side of the shaft. So a little stuff will dribble out, but it's not gonna shake, it's not gonna vibrate, and it's no grease, no bearings. It'll run for ages. Nylon is underestimated a lot of times. I think nylon can fix a lot of things. Also right here, Leg Arms just did this. He just wired in a on-off switch for the Intelligent Ag blockage system. We used to have it, we had to take the battery terminals off or pull the relay out to shut it down. Now it's just a switch. Good job, Leg Arms.
Last year I broke something, the axle shaft on the press wheels. I gotta pull them apart, measure the shaft, cut a new shaft, put it on the lathe, thread it, put a keyway on it, assemble. Let's get it going. Press wheels are not easy to get off. We've just cut them, and that's what we're doing. He's gonna cut the press wheel, and then we'll pull that collar off, make a new axle.
Spending every spare moment of time that we've had inside that shop working on that big bud. And we're really close to getting it done. So the other thing that's going on though, is it's about ready to time to plant. I think the ground is ready, the drills are ready, We have pretty much all of our product and everything ready to go. We really need to get this building right here cleaned out because we don't have room for like the fertilizer truck, the seed truck in case it rains. We'd like to put our sprayers in there in case it gets cold at night because we got to do some spraying soon. So we decided to go ahead and start hauling grain. We're going to haul hard, and our goal is to get that building emptied, maybe not in one day, but in two at least, with these two buttes right here. We would take the new International 9370, but it's just not quite tested yet, and we need this stuff to go right now. This isn't a good time to test the truck out, so we're going to run these two, get this wheat done. Let's haul some grain. So we had a few items stashed in the front of there because there was a little bit of room where we could put stuff, but we'll get that cleaned out. So this is all opened up now, enough room for that loader to get in here and scoop this pile out. Can't wait to get this building open and cleaned out because guess what's going in the very back? Two case combines. Let's go get the vac in place because we can start pulling out the side of the building right now. Okay, they're getting the vac just hooked up to the building. I'm gonna go grab a truck, get underneath there so we can start loading because they're opening out the elevators and we can be hauling. And the loader's running too. I think we'll get a lot done. Living life on the edge every day. It's pretty slick having a monitor in the truck. These halo views are really nice. I can just sit in the cab through the majority of the truck and just fill it with looking at the screen. Pretty sweet. That loader's a little heavy. His ground is turning into a sponge. That's hilarious. That'll do. That ought to get me there back. Originally, we were gonna load it mainly with the grain vac and use the loader to just push the mounds to the vac, but it's just as fast to load the loader. And oh, lost my sunglasses. So, new pair. Oh, that's more like it. My rods and cones are very happy right now. I believe this is legal weight. That's usually about how we fill it to make it legal, so I'll find out when I get on the scale how close we are. Well, my guessing game is paying off. 850 bushels on the dot. 78,400 pounds. Now we're pretty fortunate where we live with our farm. We're so close to town. It's only literally a 2.5 mile haul, mostly downhill. So we can move a lot of wheat pretty fast, especially with these 40 foot grain trailers. There's no reason to go much bigger than this because I can turn around. As long as they can dump me quick down at the elevator, I can get back to the farmyard in under probably 30 minutes. We can turn around a lot of wheat really quick. steep decline with not much of a space here to slow down before the train tracks and the highway. So you just gotta make sure you cross this hill going pretty slow in a low gear, grind away with Jake's on, lightly run the brakes, and get stopped in time before those train tracks, because you don't have a lot of room to slow down. It looks like we do have a train coming. Let's see, I think I can make it across. The crossings weren't down yet. He's not moving as fast as I thought he was, so I went ahead and just ran across the tracks. It wasn't too bad. Normally, if I see a train coming down the other side, though, they're coming in pretty hot, and I usually stop, even if the crossing guards aren't even down yet. But here's my stop right here. They call this the North Elevator. Because of weight restrictions with bridge laws and road, you know, these trucks can beat up roads pretty bad and they're pretty heavy. We're not allowed to fill these trucks plumb full on public roads like that. So we probably fill the truck maybe 80% of what it's capable of filling, 75%, but it's okay. The short haul makes up for the lack of load in the back. On the bright side, the wind's blowing the right direction, so I can have my window down and not worry about dust just engulfing me. Something to be thankful for. Always be thankful for something. There we go. First load's down. Protein was 12.5%. This is spring wheat, so it's a little lower than we like, but the scales right now are really friendly to low protein farmers. Look at that. Someone's waiting for me. Let's take a look and see how things are going over here. That's at least two-thirds done. That's pretty good. So here's what we got going on. I'm gonna go ahead and get the auger underneath the peas, and get one of the trucks loaded up, because we gotta get product in those trucks, the two Fords over here. So we can get product into the drills so we can calibrate them to make sure they're set correctly. Right now, everything has got to get done right now. Let's go. Okay, auger's in place. Now I gotta get some fertilizer. Because this isn't the fertilizer, this is the piece. All right, let's wake them up. My thumb's strong enough to press the button. There we go. Wussy hands. It'll start, just give it a second. There we go. So what they're going to do here is they're going to batch up some 1152 for us for our peas. We ran that last year and I think I had good results, so we'll do it again this year. Peas don't require as much nitrogen as they do with more phos, so we're going to get more phosphorus in the ground. But yeah, so anyways, this thing's going to make a lot of banging and noises and all kinds of stuff as it's mixing up all the ingredients. And then when this light right here turns green, it's going to start dumping in my truck really fast. So I got to be careful to stay with it and follow the light coordination to make sure this truck fills up full and I don't spill any on the ground, because they don't want a mess here. Okay. Now I need some seed treat for the peas, because we didn't get that yet. So I gotta go to town, get some seed treat for the peas, then I can treat the peas onto the truck out of the bin. And then we'll have the trucks ready to fill the air drills, which is hopefully gonna happen tonight or tomorrow. All right, so right here is the seed treat. That goes on the peas. I already got some in my hands, as you can see. Don't worry, I'm not going to die. Maybe. No, it's not that bad. It's just very... He's throwing peas at me. It's kind of weird. I had this pump right here. They gave it to us to transfer this to another treat setup that we have. So that works there. Here's all of our inoculant. Difference between these two guys, real quick. Treat goes on the seed shell in the ground, protects the seed from funguses and bacteria and stuff in the ground. There's disease and stuff too. The inoculant, on the other hand, is actually a living organism that we put on the seed too, and when it grows and the roots start growing, this organism will actually start growing on the root structure of the peas. They work together in unison, and these actually will help create what's called nodules, which produces nitrogen. So a lot of scientific fancy-dancy stuff that, you know, I'm not very good at explaining, but the bottom line is it works, and we got to do it. So that's what that stuff is. It's pretty good. First load of yellow peas turned blue. Oh, there. Okay, we got over 20,000 bushels of grain hauled in. We got some room in the building, enough to at least park the trucks, maybe a sprayer in there. We'll finish the rest of that in a day or two. We got seed, we got treat, we treated a load of peas. I've got fertilizer. These air drills and big buds are like 99% ready to go. So I think tomorrow we're gonna go ahead and calibrate these things and start seeding, kick off plant 19. So thanks for watching, guys. Please like and subscribe, and stay tuned for the next episode. God bless, catch you guys later.